In my limited experience, I think there are three major religions which are very good at helping us to face most of the realities with which life confronts us. They are Judaism, Buddhism, and Christianity. It is well known that Prince Gautama Buddha was brought up sheltered from realities such as disease, sickness, death, and poverty. When he finally saw these realities, he abandoned his father's palace, his wife and family, to follow the life of an ascetic beggar and seek enlightenment. The rest of the 40 years of his life after his enlightenment was devoted to teaching what he had learned. Now, in the Christian tradition, the reality of death and suffering is staring us in the face in the shape of the cross of Jesus. In any church, you really can't get away from it. But familiarity dulls our senses of what it might mean. And T.S. Eliot, in one of his great poems, reminded us, humankind cannot bear very much reality. Yet that should not prevent us from trying to face reality. We have to recognize that Jesus was an observant Jew, not a Christian, who saw himself in the great tradition of the Jewish prophets. During recent years, I've been carving the crosses you see for the bedrooms of Laund Abbey, which is the Leicester Diocesan Retreat and Conference House, which you saw to begin with. Now, nearly all the wood I use comes from the Abbey grounds. I started making simple crosses, resolving not to repeat myself, and soon I realized that the marks in the grain of the yew wood and inside the wood itself could suggest a bent head, the inclined head of the crucified. And then I became bolder and looked for inspiration in medieval ivory carvings, such as those on display in the Courtauld collection in Somerset House by the River Thames. This one is an enlarged copy of part of a mid-14th century semi-relief. Here, I am exploiting the contrast between the white sapwood and the dark heartwood of the yew. I present Christ on the cross, just like the ivory carvings, with their distorted limbs. Later, I attempted to combine the themes of the crucifixion of Christ with his resurrection. Because the whole drama of the Passion and Resurrection make up the central score of what the Christian churches regard as the salvation of the whole world. Now, it would take ages to explain that, but in a nutshell, as we look at the saving compassion of Jesus and his self-sacrifice, we are moved to follow him. But we can tie ourselves in knots trying to explain how it works. And perhaps that's why I've really sort of abandoned theology and tried to carve it. I was on retreat at the St. Bino's Spirituality Centre in North Wales when I found an ash tree branch in the right shape for a crucifix. It reminded me of a famous curved crucifixion figure in Arezzo, painted by the Italian artist Cimabue. The curve in the body in my figure goes the opposite way to Cimabue's, but it still expresses vividly the agony. Unlike the Cimabue crucifix, he is depicted here totally naked, because the Romans intended to humiliate their victims as completely as possible. Again, I feel this one prefigures Christ's resurrection, because the hands are not nailed to the cross anymore, but he is, as it were, leaping from the cross and rising. In traditional churches, which have quite often have a rood screen right across the top of the chancel arch, Christ is often shown on the cross between Mary and John. And during Lent and at other times, music is sung entitled Stabat Mater, Juxta Crucis, meaning the mother stood next to the cross. To look at that image and to enter into the reality of the awful anguish of a mother witnessing her son's torture as he dies must be one of the most painful of all human realities. If we can bear to look at that and see God at work in it, then I think we're beginning to grow in our understanding of the purpose of God in enabling us to face such a reality. Indeed, it may strengthen and enable us to offer compassion and help to alleviate the suffering of people we know and some people we don't know. For to do so is to follow Christ in his life and in his death. It is worth remembering that Christ, under the most extreme pain, nailed to the cross, was able to commend his mother into the care of John and to suggest that John should think of Mary as his mother too. After encountering this most awful death, Mary and John do in fact enter into a kind of resurrected life together with the disciples. It's as if they all died a kind of death when Jesus died, and life after that became resurrected life. It is quite extraordinary that what should have been utter disaster after the death of their leader and teacher is seen instead as a miraculous rising again by the disciples. And it's this that I've been trying to carve as a semi-relief. Now, in the letters section of the New Testament, there is one entitled The First Letter of Peter. In one of the verses, it reads, "He," that's Jesus, "was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he also went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison," meaning under the earth, in Hades or hell. In the Christian tradition in Europe in particular, and in medieval morality plays, such as the Chester Cycle, this event becomes known as the harrowing of hell. And it is shown by Jesus trampling on the gates of hell. Hell, or Hades, is depicted at the bottom of the picture. But more important is the action of Christ rising and raising. On his left, he is raising up Eve. And on his right, he is about to raise up Adam, representing the two halves of humanity. And by an accident in the growth of this wood, there was a protuberance on the right here. So I carved another figure here, in front of Eve. She has to be, of course, the Blessed Virgin Mary. Behind both Adam and Eve, there are representational cues of other souls being raised up, including a bishop and a king even. And round the corner, a skeptical person, probably one of those nuns. Now, the whole point of this is to emphasize that resurrection is and will be available to everyone. And I suppose the main question is, what are we being raised up or liberated from? The main answer is death and sin. Being raised up from death in all its forms, such as injustice and racism and poverty, and you name the rest. Now, what interests me most about this image is the fact that in the Western Church, resurrection pictures and images usually show the individual Christ rising up out of the tomb on his own. Whereas in the frescoes and icons of the Eastern churches, Christ is shown sharing his rising with all of humanity. And actually, I prefer that thought.